If you're not getting confused now, I don't know what to tell you. So, because I am. But that's okay. That's why we have calendar, right?
Yep.
Good. All right. Well, it is good to see everybody here today. And we just want to worship the Lord and lift him up and invite the Holy Spirit to join us this morning. So you guys stand with us and let's worship his name.
Holy is
At the mention of his name, walls crumble, lives change. In the midst of life's temptation, he's there to see us through. This man of which I speak is here today. Name is Jesus. You can call him as you please. They call him Emmanuel, the King of all kings. He's the Son of the Father, the Prince. They call him Hosanna, a lighthouse at sea, the Rock of Ages. He's a friend to me. Many times I've called his name, prayed for forgiveness and spoke in vain. But there's a peace in knowing his forgiveness stays the same. Most famous in his story, things he spoke, the whole world still reads. His name is Jesus, but you can call him as you please. They call him Emmanuel, the King of all kings. He's the Son of the Father, the Prince of Peace. They call him Hosanna, a lighthouse at sea, the Rock of Ages. He's a friend to they call him Hosanna, a lighthouse at sea, the Rock of Ages. He's a friend to me. Yes, the Rock of Ages. He's a good friend to me.
this next song. It's about an old man, lost part of his family, but he knew he was going to see him again one day, you know, because he believed. You know, when Jesus died and rose and he came back, Thomas never believed, and he told him, "Stick your finger in my side. Now do you believe?" You know, those words in red in that Bible are so powerful. When you read those words in red, how do you not believe? How do you make that up? And God has awesome words in the Bible. Been around for years, and the more you read those words in red, the more you believe and the more faith there is. And that's what this song's about. You believing with all your heart. Old man Reggie lived in that White House down the street where I grew up. Mom, you sent me over with things. We struck a friendship up. Spent a few long summers out on his old porch swing. Said he was in the war, went in the Navy. Lost his wife. Lost his baby. Broke down and asked him one time, "How you keep from going crazy?" He said, "I'll see my wife and son in just a little while." I asked him what he meant. He looked at me and smiled. Said, "I raised my hands and I bowed my head. I'm finding more and more truth in these words written in red. They tell me that there's more to life than just what I can see. Oh, I believe." Later, I was off at college, talking to Mom on the phone one night, getting all caught up on the gossip, ins and outs of the small town life. She said, "Oh, by the way, son, old man Wrigley has died." Later on that night, laid there thinking back, thought about a couple of long lost summers. I didn't know whether to cry or laugh. If there's ever anybody deserve that ticket to the other side, it'd be that sweet old man. Looked me in the eyes and I raised my hands and I bowed my head. Word written in red. They tell me that there's more to life than just what I can see. I can't quote the book, a chapter or a verse. You can't tell me it's all ends in a slow ride in a hearse. You know I'm more and more convinced longer that I live. Yeah, this can't be. No, this can't be. This can't be all there is. Oh, I raise my hands, bow my head. Oh, I find more and more truth in those words written in red. They tell me that there's more to this, just what I can see. I believe, oh,
Generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb, and all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. Song forever to the Lamb. If you walk in freedom and if you bear his name, sing the song forever to the Lamb. We'll sing the song.
Well, that's a good-looking picture there, isn't it? Oh, the granddaughter, yeah. That's what I was thinking. That's what I was talking about. So, yesterday evening I was asked to, actually a couple of weeks ago, I guess, that my son, would be working probably, and would I do, careful, would I do the father-daughter dance with my oldest granddaughter? My first thought is, my son's asked me this, so that means most of the father's going to be probably his age. And I'm going to stick out like a sore thumb. But I tell you what, her mom bought her new shirt, new dress, new pair of shoes and everything. And so I go in the shower yesterday, take me a shower getting ready. And Nana was fixing her hair, making it all look pretty and everything. And we get up there. I take her out to eat. We go eat. She wanted pancakes. So we went to Cracker Barrel. And so we got up there because it was raining all day. And finally it quit raining. So we was walking there. Boy, she was so excited. Excited. How many of y'all feel that kind of excitement very much anymore? This little girl is going to a daddy-daughter dance with her papa. And I'm nervous because I'm the oldest son going to be up here. And so they have it at the junior high in Hazel. Well, the junior high in Hazel was a high school when I went there. So I'm thinking, okay, this is going to be weird. So we get there, and we take several different pictures, and we go walk around. They got these little light things that they can strobe light things, and they're playing around and having a bunch of good time. And so I see some other old farts around there. Thought, okay, cool, I'm not the oldest one here. And so we're up there. She's doing a little craft thing, and this guy walks up and says, "You know who I am?" I said, "No, man, I'm sorry, I don't remember you." He said, "You know me, I'm on Facebook together." I said, "Okay, well, I'm sorry, I still don't know who you are." He said, "Man, we went to school together." I said, "What?" I said, "Okay, you're up here with the grandkids?" "No, I got four girls up here myself." I said, "Ooh." I'm glad I'm in my shoes, not in your shoes. Here was a guy that I went to school with that had four girls that were, and this was, I guess, kindergarten through, I don't know what grade. They were probably up this high anyway. So I'm thinking, oh, man, I'm glad I'm where I'm at, and he's not where, I'm not where he's at. So you think about that. God works in mysterious ways. But he's excited about his four girls. I'm excited about my granddaughter. Now, I've got a grandson, that, you know, he's 16. I got him all the way down to 3 years old. But, man, what a great joy that was. And I say that because we never know what our future is. We don't know what's in store for us. Micah said, "Man, I don't know, son. I'm kind of old. You know, something you need to do." But he was doing what he needs to do. And I did what I needed to do. And that's what we're supposed to be doing each and every day. God has something for us to do each and every day, no matter what, because we don't know what blessings God's going to have in it for us. And if we don't take that opportunity, we're going to miss out on it. Man, we got home, and my son was home by then. He stayed with us so he could see his girls this weekend. And she was telling him all about it. Yeah, she stretched the truth. Papa danced real good with her because I know I didn't. But you know what? She was excited. And to see that joy in her smile and her excitement, she was telling her little sister about it. So each and every day we're faced with opportunities. Don't miss the little things. Because you do, guess what? I'll never forget that night. And she might not forget for a long time. She might have something, you know, prom later on that takes the place of it. But we got that memory right there. So let's go, Lord, in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much every day that you give us opportunities, Lord, to be part of your presence, be a part of your blessings. Lord, I pray that each and every day we don't miss those opportunities. Just like today, Lord, it sprung on me last minute, but yet we put our faith and trust in you because you got this. You got it all. Just like we're going to learn today, Lord, without you, we're nothing. Lord, without our trust in you, we can have nothing. Lord, I thank you so much for the opportunity you present to us. Lord, just be with me. Open my mouth to speak what you have me to say. Put myself aside. And just now I pray. Amen. So did everybody have a good week this past week? You didn't like rain? Are you working it? Well, say, what you probably got used to it a couple weeks ago, didn't you? I tell you what, I started off my week, I had to go to Dallas. Had to go to a CPR instructor class in Dallas. Now, when I say Dallas, I'm not talking about the outskirts of Dallas. I'm not talking about Mesquite or one of those other outside areas in Dallas. I'm talking about downtown Dallas. So I get to Bucky's. I got to stop at Bucky's, especially in the morning. I've got to get a brisket taco. Have you ever had the brisket taco at Bucky's? They are delicious. They're overpriced, but they're good. So I get to Bucky's, and I get on my phone, and I put in the address to where I'm going to go, and it's got two routes. I can go east and go north, or I can go around and go north and go east, or go west, excuse me. So I'm looking at which one's quickest, and I find the quickest way, which is going north and go west. I said, okay, that's where I'm going. So I put my phone up in my dash of my truck, and there's where we're going. I got about 10 miles down the road, and guess what? A wreck. So it says 30 minutes delay. I thought, crap, I should have went the other way. So I'm sitting there, I'm starting praying, God, I put my faith and trust in this little thing that size. I put my faith and trust in this thing. The little bitty old thing sitting up on my dash. I thought, okay, well, I'd already put my trust in this thing, so I'm going to see it through. You know, it tells me where I'm going to go because I don't know where I'm going. I'm going downtown Dallas. I'm going to be lost. So finally get through that traffic jam through there and gets off of 80 there, and, man, I'm going down some roads and some scenery that I hope my truck makes it through because it was a pretty rough out part of town. My faith in my little phone becomes stronger because it's going to tell me how to get out of that area to where I need to be. And I was going to this Red Cross building, which is in a bigger area of Dallas, downtown Dallas, but I was going through the smaller areas, the outskirts of it. Man, you remember those times we didn't have GPSs and phones that told us where to get to places, and we had little maps, and we had to, you know, read turn-by-turn directions, and we got where we was going. But, man, now we trust these little things, and I hoped this thing was not going to lie to me. I use it a lot in my work. People see me drop pins, and it takes me where they're at. But how many times I take it for granted that that's where I'm going to go, that that's where I'm going to end up? It's just like this passage we're going to go into today. If you got your Bibles, we're going to spend most of our time in Philippians 4. So here we're talking about Paul's writing to the church in Philippi. Now, at this particular time, Paul's in prison. So where is he at? He's in prison. Is he walking around being able to go to Philippi? Is he able to go and share with them personally? He's in prison having to write to them. He's not in a good situation himself, right? He's not a free man. He's not, you know, walking around going to eat where he wants to or anything else. People have to bring him food while he's in prison. So he's in prison. He's telling these church of Philippi they're experiencing trouble within their church. How many times we experience trouble with our church? How many times we experience trouble within ourselves, even our relationships, work or anything? So they got chaos going on. But he's telling them, just like he tells us, to settle a disagreement. That's all it is, settle a disagreement. Get over it. How many times we get our feelings hurt over some little thing? You know, guess what? We're grown adults. I always say I got feeler. I only got one feeling left, right? Kind of a joke. You know, you've been married more than 2 days, you probably don't have any feelings left, right? Isn't that right, Dean?
Yes, sir.
Okay. He was ignoring that one because he didn't want to answer. You know what? We got to be tough. We can't let little things get to us very easily. But guess where this disturbance is coming from? Two women. They caused some chaos in this church. That could be us. It didn't have to be women. It could be me and you. It could be anything. We don't agree to each other. But Paul's giving them encouragement here. So we're going to start in verse 4. Always be full of joy in the Lord. How often we should be Be joyful. Always. Man, I can't be joyful all the time. That's just hard to do. So he's already starting out with a challenge here. He's telling us to always be full of joy. I try to be, but I'm not that little person who goes, well, I'm happy, happy, happy all the time. Because guess what? Life bucks, right? Life's hard. It's not always bed of roses. Being a Christian, I remember the time I got baptized. You know, you wash away the old, rise in the new. Boy, it's going to be a great life. I'm new and born being Christian. Is it easy? No. Life still happens. Life will always happen. But always be joyful in the Lord. That's the key part. In the Lord. Can that change? Whose choice is that, to be joyful in the Lord? That's mine. That's my sanctification, right? So I have that choice to be joyful in the Lord. When times are hard, what am I going to do? I'm going to focus on Him. So life's full of choices. We choose each and every day how we're going to be that day. You know, I can tell the difference whenever I wake up, go to work, pull my Bible out, start reading it. Or if I get to work, turn on my computer, start reading my emails. I can tell what kind of day I'm going to have because how I started it off. I made that choice. Can we choose to be full of anger? I can. That was my life for a long time. I knew nothing but anger. So that was my surroundings. But we had the choice to change that. I had wrote back another. Life's not fair. Get over it. Because guess what? If you don't, life's going to get worse and worse. So what is Paul's next comment? It says, I say it again, rejoice. Do you think Paul forgot what he said in the first part of the verse? He didn't forget it. Why did he restate it? Because that's important, right? He wanted to reiterate, rejoice in the Lord. Because he knew that was important to us. If we couldn't rejoice in the Lord, what else would we have to be rejoiceful for? Absolutely nothing. So he knew if we focus on that right there, life's not always going to be easy, but through the Lord it'd be a lot better. So, on verse 5, let everyone see that you are considerate in all you do. So what does that mean? These are some verses that I've read many times. I've heard it, and I read it, but did I understand it? So when I started studying for this, I said, I want to look for understanding because words have meaning. So what does this part of it mean? It says, let everyone see that you are considerate in all you do. Are you the same outside the church you are inside this church? Do you leave here and go out to eat, and you cuss the waitress staff? Do you leave out of here and get mad at somebody driving their road next to you because they cut you off, or they go slower in front of you? How are you outside these walls? Man, I tell you what, it's easy to come in here and put on your nice shirt, put on your nice hat, then you walk outside and it rains on you. Isn't it? We've had a lot of rain lately. Go out there and step in a mud hole, get your boots muddy. Guess what? They wash off. You probably need a shower anyway. We was out. My granddaughter spent the weekend with us. First thing they want to do, they want to hit the woods. So we go in, hit the woods, and first one said, I got a potty. I thought, man, we just left the house. We just walked across creek, now you got a potty. I said, well, pop a squat over by a tree or something. And also the next one, I got a potty. Y'all want to go in the house or you want to stay out here? We want to stay here. We'll find you a tree then. So we're out there walking around in the woods. And, of course, we got these big Great Dane dogs. Aren't Great Danes. Great Pyrenees dogs. And when they use the bathroom, usually they go out in the woods. So we're walking around the woods. I tell the little three-year-old, I said, watch where you step. Don't step there. Don't step there. And so we're walking around. The other one's running around, and we're trying to catch up with her. And pretty soon, the little one says, I stepped in poo. Oh, my gosh. Well, she's got the Crocs on. It's no big deal. We wash the Crocs off. So Mike calls me. I'm on the phone with Mike. I'm trying to catch two girls running around the woods. All of a sudden, guess what I do? Wasn't the same spot. Was a different spot, but I stepped in too. But you know, it's like this right here. What do? We walk up to the house. I grab, take my shoes off, take her shoes off. I wash it off. Life stinks. Wash it off. Keep going. We just rubbed it on the ground a little bit, and we kept on walking through the woods at the time. We'll wash it off when we get back to the house. That's what we got to do. Did I get mad? Did I cuss at her? No, because I did the same thing. So as we point some fingers at somebody else, guess what? We got three, four, how many fingers you got on one hand, we got that pointing back at us. I know some people are missing a couple digits, so you can't really say four. So as we get mad at somebody else, what are we like? What are we exhibiting to them? Hey, man, I hate that you cut me off. You know, I had that happen several times when I come back from Dallas, man. Road rage is pretty bad. I had to turn up the radio so I wouldn't hear my thoughts. Have you ever done that before? But you know what? I got home safely. We will get there. Might take me a little longer. Might get a little slower. But you know what? Try to let people see Christ in you. For many times I've made that prayer with me and Delia pray in the morning. God, I want to be more and more like you each and every day. Man, I ain't there yet. I get frustrated. I get upset. A little bit of my background comes through every now and then. But you know what? I keep moving forward. You know why our toes are on this side of our foot and not on this side? Because that's the way we're supposed to walk, right? Forward. We ain't got toes on the back of our heels. We got toes pointing forward, so that's the direction we need to be going. Just like this church. Just like you each and every day. Remember the next verse. Remember, the Lord is coming soon. How many people believe that the Lord is coming back again? It says it right here. Paul says it many times. The Lord is coming. When? Soon. When is that? Paul wrote this a long time ago. Guess what? It could be right now. It could be next week. But you know what? He is coming. What are we supposed to be doing? Being prepared. I told the story the other day whenever Delia was in the hospital here a while back. We had a little storm come through. All of a sudden, our electricity went out. About 10 seconds later, guess what? Electricity come back on, but it wasn't because the power came back on. It's because my generator kicked off. I was prepared for that. Are you prepared for when Jesus comes back? I hope so. Because you know what? At that time, it's going to be too late. Verse 6, this is one that really stuck out to me. Don't worry about anything. Don't worry. Remember a song that, who was, don't worry, be happy. Who? Yeah, don't worry, be happy. Yeah, easy for you to say. You ain't living life, you're just up there singing a song, right? But you know what? Don't worry about anything. How many times you worry about something? Where does it get you? Nowhere. We're going to see that in just a second. So we're going to finish this verse out. So don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. So worry. What does worry do for you? We're going to look at Luke 12, verse 25 and 26. It's kind of neat about this passage through here. It's just Jesus teaching about money and possessions. But he says, you know, he goes in here and he talks about the clothing and food. But what I'm focusing on, it says, 25 says, can all your worries add a single moment to your life? How much effort does it take to worry? A lot of times it takes quite a bit of effort. It takes a lot of stress when you're worrying. It says, can all your worries add a single moment to your life?
And if worry can't accomplish a little thing like that, what's the use of worrying over bigger things? I know people that worry about all kinds of little things. Man, I can worry about tomorrow. I can worry about what we're going to eat this evening. Has Delia prepared? Has she already thought about what we're going to have to eat this evening? It ain't going to matter. We'll go to the refrigerator and we'll find something. It's kind of neat because we're kind of older now. Guess what? We can have dessert for breakfast. We can have dessert for lunch. We can eat what the heck we want. You know, we're not putting out an example for our kids anymore. We ain't got to eat sometimes. Probably wouldn't hurt me every now and then anyway. But you know what? We don't require as much anymore. But worrying is not going to cure anything. Worry is not going to help anything. All we got to do is put our faith and trust in God. Because you know what? Worrying is not going to add one day to my life. Worrying is not going to add anything to my life besides stress and chaos. And I don't want that. I don't need that. I got something else to worry about. I got something else to put my effort into. So God, let's go back to verse 6. It said, instead, pray about everything. So we pray about just the things we worry about. We pray about everything, right? We pray about. I remember one time when Sean first came over to Trails End when he was over on Leswich Road. On Wednesday nights, we bring our prayers up in front. We pray about them. And he made a comment about us, man, they pray about everything over there. Yeah, that's what it tells us right here. Pray about everything, right? I mean, we all need prayer. If you say you don't need prayer, guess what? You need prayer. Because there's something you ain't looking at. I tell them, trust me, I need a lot of prayer, a lot of times. Be specific in your prayers. Your prayer time is a time between you and God. I was sitting in this morning, I was sitting in our prayer room, which we got two spare bedrooms. One is designated just for our prayer room, study room. So I'm sitting there in my red chair that somebody gave me. And I'm sitting there reading my Bible. I'm looking up. I look across the room, and guess what? There's pictures of all four of our grandkids. And around there, they got notes, little post notes around them with prayers on them. Oh my gosh, yes. Each one of them has different prayers, what's going on with them. There are a lot more sticky notes all over that wall. One says, prayer is the key. Another one says, don't be afraid, just believe. These are prayers that my wife had put up on our prayer wall. And guess what? I look real close and there's one little sticky note, a yellow sticky note right there. Guess what it says? Dale. She knows I need prayer, a lot of prayer. Then I see one with our son, one with our daughter. Now, another wall, there's one for Clint. There's one up there for Ashton up on that wall. What a great room. I know my wife prays for me. I know I pray for her. Sometimes we say, man, the only thing I can do is pray for you. That's the most you can do is pray for somebody. Because guess what that exhibits? Faith and trust in who? God. What more can we do besides trust God for a situation? How many times we said that God hasn't answered our prayers? When true in reality, he really has. It may be that the answer is no, but that isn't the answer we're looking for. Have you ever felt that before? So we just mark that up as God hasn't answered our prayer yet. We experienced that several years ago. Delia was praying about a job situation. She was working at a job, and she felt that she might need to quit that job. But man, you know what? We need the money. We need her income to help us. So she stayed there. A few months rocked around and situation happened and they let her go. dadgum, that's kind of rough. But guess what happened after that? She needed to do God. She needed to do what God needed her to do. She needed to be there with my parents as their health was declining. She was a very big asset for me because I couldn't do things that she was able to do because of she was able to stay there with her, with my parents. We almost missed that. Then later on, guess what? She was there with her mom. She's been there with our grandkids. She's there when God needs her to. She's available. She's here with other people in this church. But God answered us no. Why? Because he had something else for us. He had a plan for that. Paul tells us to thank God for all he has done. We don't thank him just for what he's done in the past. We thank him for right now. God sometimes tells me no because he knows if I'm not ready for it. Sometimes it's not yet. Later on, because I know if I had done it then, when I thought I needed to be doing it, and you know, if God granted me that wish then, I would have messed it up. Because I can mess something up. Am I the only one? Y'all left me hanging there. Nobody said amen after that one. We can all mess things up though, right? Man, give me enough time, I can make a mess out of anything. But you know what? With God's help, it's less of a mess because he works through me and he works for me. How many times it said, excuse me, verse 7. Then we will experience his peace, not our peace, his peace. So you kind of understand that. Then we will experience God's peace. First of all, it says then. Then means we have something first. If we do this, then this will happen. So if we do the first part, if we trust in God, if we quit worrying, if we start praying, then we will experience God's peace. So remember, words have meaning. So when you see the word then, there's something before that. Usually after that, there's a blessing. But we got to do the first part first. So Paul says, then we will experience God's peace, which exceeds everything we can understand. You know one thing I've always realized? I'm smart enough to know I'm not smart enough. There's things out of my understanding, much more. So when we stop worrying, praying about everything, then thanking him for listening to our prayers and answering them, then we'll experience God's peace. The peace, in some translations, say that peace that which surpasses all understanding. That's the peace we can't understand, that surpasses all understanding. So back earlier this year when Dalia was diagnosed with colon cancer, we was nervous. We were worried. You hear about others, that stuff happened to others like that, right? But when it happens to you or a loved one, it's different. It's real. And it's personal. Says we did what Paul tells us to do. We tried not to worry. We prayed that God would intervene in this. We thanked him in advance for him intervening. But guess what? She still had cancer. One day I got home and Dalia told me that she had that peace. What peace? She said the peace that surpasses all understanding. She couldn't describe this peace, but she knew she had it. At that moment, I felt a release that I couldn't describe, a peace that only God could give. This was his peace that guarded our hearts and minds as we live in Christ Jesus. Until you reach that peace, because you know that it's not your worries, it's not you that take on that burden, Because when you turn those words over to God, guess what? He said, that's mine. How many times we want to turn it over to God like this? We want to keep that one hand on it because, you know, I might need this. I might get bored sometimes. I might need to worry about something. Or I might be able to do it better than God. Has anybody tried to do that? You try to do it better than God? Guess what? We can't. Because once we turn it over to God, we let Him have control over it. Remember, prayer is the key. When you pray to God, you say you're going to give it over to Him. Let go of it. Don't hold on to it any longer. God's peace is different from the world's peace. True peace is not found in positive thinking, in the absence of conflict, or in good feelings. How many times do we hear that on TV? Or somebody just telling us, you know, good vibes, you know, just if you have happy thoughts. No, that doesn't work. We're looking for God's peace. It comes from knowing that God is in control. Man, just like Sean, whenever I hear these songs, as I hear these verses, these things, I think of songs, and I hear about, you know, God is in control. I remember hearing Ayn Grant talk about, singing about that a lot. I know you've heard me say several times, you know, I can't, he can, why don't I let him? I didn't come up with that. I heard that from somebody else. But how many times I use that? Many times. In verse 8, it says, and now is kind of like the final saying. It says, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. He's driving home the nail right now. He's driving home the point that he wants to make to us. Paul's not just trying to wrap his statement up here. He's about to make the main point. He is giving us the reason and the purpose for doing all this. He says, fix your thoughts on what is true, honorable, and right, and pure, and lovely, and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. I showed y'all a picture of that of my granddaughter and me. When I was thinking about pure and lovely, I was thinking about my granddaughter. But that's not what he means here. I was thinking about that time I spent with my granddaughter. Man, it's a great time. That's not what he's talking about here. I had a mentor that used to use this quote this verse to me a lot. It always sounded good and encouraging, but I never knew what it really meant. It's very difficult to ways to think of what is true, honorable, right, pure, lovely, admirable. It's not talking about each and every one. It's talking about all of these. How many things that you know you check off each and every one of those? I can't. I couldn't until I kept reading and kept reading this. Even I know how much I love my wife and how much she loves me, I couldn't check off every one of those marks until I thought about what he's really trying to tell me. Things that are excellent and worth praise. What or who could fill this category? There's only one person, Jesus Christ. When you think about Jesus Christ, is he true? Is he honorable? Is he right? Is he pure? Is he lovely? Is he admirable? Is he excellent and worthy of praise? It finally came to me, finally understood what he was trying to say here. Jesus Christ is the answer. Jesus Christ is the one that gives you each and every one of these. Without him, we're nothing. But without giving him this, he is nothing. So each and every day I pray that, Lord, just make me more and more like you each and every day. Not that all at one time, because I couldn't handle it. I'd mess it up. But if I know I'll do one of these at a day, if I know that I look to him and pray that he is the one that shows true, honorable, right, pure, lovely, admirable. And I can truly say he's excellent and worthy of praise. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you so much, Lord, that we can, and we do fail at many things each and every day. Lord, but we know when we come to you, Lord, we just put our faith and trust in you. Lord, that you guide us. You guide us in understanding. Lord, I don't have it all down. I don't understand everything I'm reading here. But Lord, I know the more and more I read it, and the more and more I put my faith and trust in you, that you reveal yourself, because it's your word that we're reading. And the more we look at your word, the more it teaches us what your commandment is for us. And Lord, I pray each and every day, Lord, that we become more and more like you each and every day, because you sent your son to die on a cross for sin, because we will, through him, be with you in heaven forever. Lord, I thank you so much for the people that's here. Lord, the ones that aren't here, Lord, we lift up Sean, Lord, as he traveled. Lord, we lift up Clint and Callie, Lord, as they're going through the time with Clint's cancer. Lord, we just thank you so much, and we praise you right now for the healing, Lord, that you're going to do in this life. Lord, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.